Okay, good morning, everybody. Welcome to Coffee and Art in the Morning. I'm Dee Dee. Just been chatting with the people that are here. Thanks, everybody, for being here. I already pretty much said good morning to everybody, so I won't say it again. But if you walk in during the show, just make yourself at home, grab a cup of coffee, and ignore Eileen in the corner. No, just kidding. Eileen's modding today. Oh, God, I'll give her a hard time. Okay, so I got lots of stuff to do today. I got happy mail. I got a little mini haul. I got two projects, all kinds of things going on. Maybe show some sketchbook I've been working in. And maybe if we have time, I don't know. You know, we'll see how long the show goes. But so if y'all have watched any of us streaming lately, we've either been doing file folders, rubber band books, Paula talking about her Midori, what else? Different books and how we all use them, and there's no wrong way to use any of them, so don't email me. All right, so first, let me just tell you a little bit about the project we're going to do, then I'll stop, do the happy mail and all that, and then we'll get into the project. But I wanted to talk first. Y'all know we've done different type of rubber band books. Oh, let me first give a shout out to scrappycampersisters.blogspot.com. That's Darcy and Sister Woman Jonna. I call her Sister Woman. She's Darcy. They're sisters. And they do a stream like once a month on Saturday. I think it's usually the first Saturday of every month they stream. And this time it was the Valentine's. It was a week later. But they did a duck dory. And so they made a Midori, a faux Midori out of duct tape. And then, so if y'all haven't watched it, it's up on, I think it's up on YouTube now. But if you go to scrappycampersisters.blogspot.com, you can find the information about their streams and watch their videos. So we've all done many, many rubber band books. This one we did a couple of years ago when out of file folders and a Scrabble board binding. And this was a project we did, I think it was 3 years ago actually, using file folders, one a month, and they pop out, and we did projects and with information, and I won't go through all the whole project, but I'm just showing you that how we made the book out of file folders that popped out one every month. There's a file folder with a different topic that we did. And then it's just bound with rubber bands. And the cover is made out of a Scrabble board. Okay. So, and then, you know, there's lots of people doing these too now. I mean, I think when Carrie and I did these, I don't know. I hadn't seen it before Carrie and I done it. But anyway, it's just an easy way to bind signatures, and this one happens to be with a Scrabble board. The other one that, all right, so I'm going to go from right to left because I'm going to move all my piles from one side of the room to the other. The one that I'm working on now, this is my desk journal at the moment. Again, it's just made out of chipboard covered with duct tape, and that's how it's attached with duct tape. And this is just large printer paper, what, 14 by 17? No, it's not that big. Let's see, 12, I don't know. I don't remember. It's been a while since I actually made the book. It's 11, and then the papers are double. It's 11 by 14 sheets of paper folded in half to make signatures. And you can see, I don't know how many signatures. If y'all want to ask me anything, runs away giggling, Gary. If y'all want to ask me anything, put it in caps so I know you're asking me a question. Never made one. I thought to look at these ones, maybe not. It didn't click rubber. Oh, you didn't know what we're talking about? You've made tons of file folder books, Carrie. I think you folded file folders in more ways than anybody I have ever seen, but maybe I missed something. Hey, Sandra. Okay, well, anyway, moving on. So this is just regular printer paper folded in and with rubber bands holding it into a chipboard cover. Okay, all right, Carrie. I thought you were around when we did this, the Scrabble one. No, you didn't make the Scrabble one. Okay, well, I'm thinking of somebody else then. And so this is my desk journal, and this is where I put like leftover paint and scraps and just doodling and whatever leftovers or whatever that sits on my desk. And then you can go back and play, and you know, I just whatever. It's just my desk journal, and that just means it sits on my desk. Okay, all right, Carrie. Sorry, I have you confused with somebody else. I know Paula did tons too, and she showed, well, and I'm halfway through that last dream. She did show one. Now she's into the Midoris. Okay, so that's another one with just plain paper folded, just plain, you know, printer paper, the larger sheets, folded in half, and I don't know how many pages are in each signature. But there's one, let's see how many signatures are there. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I don't know, maybe 12. I guess I could count the rubber bands. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Maybe 10 or 12 signatures in that. And so this just sits on my desk to throw whatever in. All right, so there's a different size and a different version. So we're gonna do some more ways to do that without having the rubber band show, but I'll get to that in a minute. All right, Janet. Okay, so let me quickly show you a couple of things that I got with my Michael's birthday haul money, and then I'm going to move into Happy Mail. So all I really got, they had last week, they had buy one, get one half off. So basically it means 25% off. So instead of paying $1.25 or whatever for the Americana, they're down to 75 cents or something like that. So I got, I stocked up on some of the colors that I was running low on. I probably have pretty much every color of Americana paint because I use it. This is what I use. When you see in my journals and my art, you know, all that, it's all this, it's just craft paint. And the reason I like to use craft paint, particularly Americana, is my favorite. The reason that I like to use it is it won't make your journal stick. Unless now, if you put it this thick, on a journal page, it's never going to fully dry, and it will have a tendency to stick. But if you just use it normally, painting it, then it'll dry and it won't stick. So I just like using my craft paints, as opposed to other kinds of paints you can use on canvas. Well, so I got a cherry red, a light avocado. I'm just going to show you the colors real quick. I love Americana. It's my favorite. A Tuscan red and a dioxazine purple. A Hauser medium green and a burnt umber. I'm going to show these to you so I can get them off my desk. A bright yellow and antique gold. Bleached sand and primary red. And these are in no particular order. And then the last one that's not metallic is fawn. That's that color. And then a couple of the metallics that I got were royal ruby. I love this. It's like the same thing here for worn penny. There are a little bit different versions of a copper color. So I love those two metallics. And I was out of the royal ruby. The same thing for the festive green, metallic festive green. And then just the splendid gold. The splendid gold is the closest to getting to, which it's harder and harder to find, this Liquitex soft body gold. That's about the closest I've been able to find. This is my favorite gold. It's very iridescent. But it's getting harder to find the soft body. I mean, you know, maybe they've repackaged it or something, but that's the closest one that I've found to it. Okay, so those are the colors of paint. Let me just kind of move these off onto the floor. I do have my paint cart, I have one of those plastic and metal that I put together, if y'all remember, a couple years ago, or maybe a year and a half, I don't know. I think it had to be a couple years ago on one of their big, what do you call it, sales, storage sales at Michael's. With these type of drawers, you know, these drawers like this, in a steel, metal steel cart, and it has two tiers that are good for paint. So I keep like browns, yellows, reds, and metallics on the top. Then I have greens, blues, pinks, purples on the bottom. So they're all color coded, so I can just reach over there and find them fairly easily. You like that gold too, Eileen? I know. And then of course, black and white. I always just buy the big ones like this because I go through black and white. I can go through one of these in a couple of weeks. All right. So let's see. All right, so the other couple things that I bought were, I told y'all I was out, and I haven't opened them yet because I wanted to show y'all what they look like before I open them. Because once I open them, they're getting used, and then it's like, oh, I can't show you. I've already unpackaged them. And you can get general brand at Michael's and Hobby Lobby. This pack of four different woodless graphite with the sharpener is like $10. I used a 40% off, so I got it like for $6. And it comes with HB, 2B, 4B, and 6B woodless graphite. So now that you've seen the packaging, it's getting opened up. Remember last week and I told y'all that it was, hey Lindsay, hey Harriet, whoever else I missed. I think I said hi to CB. That I was out of these woodless graphites when I was sketching last week, and I finally found one, but I needed some more. So I like the general brand. I found that the, what do you call it, brand, the Artist Loft is selling these type of things too. They're just a little scratchy. They're a little scratchy feeling for me. I don't know if that anybody else would notice it, but I do. So I like the general brand, or the, I think they're called Progresso brand. I don't even know where you get those anymore. I haven't seen them for a while. But anyway, the general woodless graphites. And like I said, there's the 2B, 4B, 6B, HB. So, you know, I love those. So when I'm always using these little metal, ones too. The other thing too, when y'all saw me working on my animal drawings, and I'll show that book after a while, if we have time at the end of the projects. You know, I draw with these so they show up on camera, but when I go to add color, either water, you know, Neocolor watercolor washes or anything, it really smears. And I knew that was going to happen when I drew them dark to show up on camera. So I'm having to fixative them, take it outside and spray them before I can really add color to them, because I'm doing them so dark with so much graphite in the sketchbook that I can't really do much washing of color, paint colors on them, because it smears. But if I, the normal way that I would be drawing is with just these little cheap Papermate 2B technical disposable pencils. But the thing about that is that when I draw with those on camera, no, you can't see what I'm drawing. So I went ahead and I'm starting to draw with these in my sketchbook so that y'all can see them. And then I'll just take them out and spray them. Hey, Harriet. I'll take them out and spray them with my fixative so that I can, you know, I don't really like using a fixative. It's a bother to me to take everything outside and spray it. But y'all are worth it. So I'm doing that. All right. Then the other thing I got another one of my general tri-tip. This one's already broken and it's really getting used. It's, you know, I mean, I'll still use this for like full coverage, but I like little points. It's the same kind of stuff that's the white plastic is like this. That's kind of erasers that I like to use. I don't like the red because it leaves marks. I'll also use, where's my Ticonderoga? I'll also use the black Ticonderoga erasers for if it's a real tough to get off. This is a good tough eraser, and it usually doesn't leave a black mark. like the red rubber erasers do. You know, like come on, like come on pencils like this. You can see I've used this one for just dipping in paint to make dots. So that's got paint on it. But so I buy the packs of these white ones to put on red rubber erasers, and then I just like the General's tri-tip. I like the way it feels. And these are only like $1.19. Like $1.19. They just feel good when you're using them. So I get one of these every couple of months. Cam likes these too. All right, so there's that. Then the last thing I got this at Hobby Lobby. I made an extra trip over to Hobby Lobby to get another one of these. And I like these. They're Master Touch. Let me see if I can get the scissors again to get the packaging off. I like these for one reason. There's lots of good fine line, you know, long liner brushes, but the reason I like these is because of the handle. I like the big thick handle because when I'm fine lining, and I'll show you this liner here, the when I'm fine lining, let me get some water on it to get the state the see, I think I bumped my camera, or did I just? Sorry, guys. Let me. Okay. I'm getting the sizing off of it there. I like to hold this in my hand when I'm doing long, you know, when I put the paint in my hand to make long. I can just feel the paint when I put the paint in my hand, fine lining it. So I love these brushes. And I like the handle. You can get nice long fine liners and other brands, but the Master's Touch just happens to make these thick handles. And they run, this one I think was $4.99. Yeah, this one was $4.99. I see them $5.99. $4.99, $5.99, 40% off coupon. Get them for a couple dollars. And so they're just great for fine lining. All right. So that's all that I got as far as a haul, I think. Oh, calendars. I did get a couple new calendars. I went by Books a Million. They still have a few $3 calendars. Well, they have actually quite a few left. They have quite a few left, but nothing that I really need or want. But I did buy three Star Wars ones. I bought a big one that's like normally $18. It's about this big, and it fits in one of those Tyvek mailers. So I got it for my grandson and out in LA, and it's a three dimension. I've already packaged it up, thinking that it was going to go in the mail today, so I'd already packaged it up. But today's President's Day, there's no mail. So, but I've already packaged it up, and it's all the bad guys. And you open it up, and they pop up. They don't really like go crazy pop out, but they lift up off the page, so they're dimensional. So he's gonna love that. He loves Star Wars. He loves the bad guys. And then I also got him one of the little. They're normally like $7 or $8. The little six, seven. I think they're 6-inch calendars. And again, I already packaged that up. But I did get myself this one. This one is the Star Wars, just the little desk one. But I like it because look at all the cool Star Wars pictures in there. So I got myself this one. Again, $3. They're normally, I took the paper off, so I don't know if it's on the box. But they're normally like $13, $14, I think. But they're all $3. So I got that one. And then I've been getting these are free if you buy two calendars, even while they're on sale. So even though I'm buying them at $3 a pop, if you buy two, you still get one of these free. And I've already given two to Cam because I got it. I've already bought more than two calendars multiple times. I actually buy more than two at a time, but if you buy two or more, you get one of these for free. And I've given Cam two, and I message him. I said, Cam, do you need another one of those book lovers? No. Calendars? No. You don't need another? No. Okay. He's a big reader, and so are his friends, but apparently he does not need any more of these. So it's the book lover's calendar. So I might give that away. All right. So I think that's all the haul stuff I got. Let me take a quick. Oh, did you have a question? I saw a good question. Yeah. You might have had, I don't know. They, if you don't remember to ask them, they sometimes, depending on who's at the register at the time Packer died, they may forget that they're giving those away. They're all behind the register. But anyway, so I think that's a cool one for Star Wars images. All right, so there's my calendars, and then I can't say I'm not ever going back and getting any more, but so far, I think I've got calendars till next February. And for those of y'all that don't know, Books a Million at the first week of February every year, all their calendars, all the leather journal ones that are normally $25, the $3, the $4, the $15, all the calendars go on sale for $3. And first week of February. I know that's not Jean tweeting me. Because Jean's here. All right, so let's see. Hey, Cass, Kathy, and and also let me, well, since Kathy just came in, I'll give some shout outs here as I think of them. Kathy just did a YouTube video. See, so it's Kathy Arbor with a U in there. That's Cass who's here. She just did another YouTube video and it was so cool. She did these kaleidoscopes. Kaleidoscope triangle pictures, and it's real cool. So if when y'all get a chance, go over there and check out Kathy Arbor's YouTube video. Okay, happy mail. I got three different happy stacks of happy mail here, and then we'll get on to our project. I think I'm looking around. I think that's what pretty much what all I have left to do. Okay, so first, let me show you what Eileen sent. And so y'all be looking for giveaways because I give these things away. So Eileen usually sends cards. It seems like now she's handed that over to CB because CB has been sending great cards. And it's funny because CB says that she can't make cards. So I told her, I tweeted her, and I said, now CB, when I show your cards, when Eileen is here, she'll be the judge is if you can make cards or not. Because they're awesome cards. All right, so this is what Eileen sent, and it was, I mean, I'm usually a pretty upbeat person. Some days I just, you have those days, and when I got all this happy mail shoved in my envelope, I mean, shoved in my mailbox, it was like, this is a good day. So this is what Eileen sent. She sent first one of these seven gypsies. If y'all have not seen these, they're little like covers, like book covers that you can make books with, and they come in different sizes, and they're hard to find now because I don't, is Seven Gypsies still in business? Does anybody know? Now that I don't have any local scrapbook stores, I don't have the archivers. I have to, if I see anything, it has to be online. So I don't even know if Seven Gypsies is around anymore. And so that little book, and then she sent two of these. I'm going to show the card last because I love her card that she made for me. I have some now inserts. Got the wrong. Okay, I don't know what size thing you're talking about, Carrie. You guys choose the archives. No, they're not in business now. Okay, so these are even better. They're even more special because Seven Gypsies is not around. Same thing for these two. So these are little packs of distressed like journals. They're like little art journals with the yellow, or I shouldn't say yellow, cream color paper in them. And so it come two in a pack. There's this one and one with just different words on it. And then the other one has a dark and a music. So, yeah. I know, right? So I'm thinking about these I'm going to give away to people that are participating in the idea collecting. If you're collecting ideas, you need one of these in your purse or your pocketbook or your pocket, whatever however you carry stuff around, backpack, whatever. Okay, so these are all, any of these are great for making, just carrying little books. Okay, Cass, thanks for stopping by for collecting little ideas until you can get them into your big notebook. The other thing that she said with these little, what do you call it? Just little envelopes, just little, these little, I know there's a name for these twistable type closures. I can't remember what they are now, but she sent a bunch of those in an array of beautiful colors for little ideas. Yes, little ideas with along with little not envelopes. What do you call these? Bags, like little miniature faux paper bags. So she sent a bunch of those as well. Okay. So she sent that. I love this card. I love this card. Hey, sister woman, we were just talking about you and your show on Saturday and gave you a shout out for your duck Dory. Okay, so this is the little card that she sent. Oop, I got a little piece of paper on there. Hang on, let me get that off. Oh, it's just this little leg there. Okay, so this is the card. And is this, I have to ask, is this a die cut, an embossing folder, and or what is this, Eileen? Where did you get this giant bee? I love the bee. I mean, and look at all the layers she put on there. There's the bee, there's this little embossed circle, there's the parchment paper, and then there's a, under that is a honeycomb layer, then there's a tissue layer. Then there's the card layer, another tissue layer, and then the card layer. I mean, this thing is layered up. It's layered up. It's a Timmy die. Okay, so that's a Timmy die. Okay, so that is so. And then, of course, she's inked it and glossy accented it. And I mean, I think it's just amazing, an amazing card. I know. Isn't it beautiful? And then she has a little believe on there. And then of course she wrote me a nice little note. And so, oh, where's, what? Well, I guess because she signed it inside, she didn't put her little name. She has been putting her name on the back. And I didn't check CB's either. CB, is your name on the back? I'm gonna have to go through and write CB, CB, CB on the back of all her cards if she did it. So yeah, I love that B. So Eileen said it's a Tim Holtz die. We call him Timmy affectionately. We call him Timmy. I don't know that he probably doesn't like that, but we call him Timmy. But it's Tim Holtz die. So I love that. See the dimension? Look at all the layers. I just love that. This is going on my inspiration. I have an inspiration shelf, and that rotates because I got so many beautiful cards and things that I have to rotate them. But I love this one. I love bees. So that was Eileen's happy mail. Let me put a, not the card, but the other stuff. Let me put a rubber band on to keep it together. So we'll probably do a giveaway here at the end of the show. Well, I can't keep it there. It'll get paint on it. All right. So I know, right? Then I got an envelope. I won't show the, there's the envelope, and it's all decorated up. Let me see if I can flip this over. This is from CB, and so she did a bunch of Zentangling, and just really cool. I'm just not letting y'all see the addresses there, although all of y'all have my address. And then she sent, and I've already taken them out of the envelope, so it's ready to show you guys. She wrapped it in some of the Timmy tissue. I love this stuff. Love this. You want his new feather die. I don't think I've, no, I think, did you show it at CHA, Sister Woman? For some reason, it sounds familiar that I've seen it, but not in stores, of course. But I think you showed it or somebody showed it at CHA. So I love this. I don't have this paper. I have his other one that just has some words on it that I got on sale, but I love this. So now let me show you the card CB sent. And now Eileen, pay attention. She says, CB says, I'm not a card maker. All right, well, this is the one that she sent me she had made a post. Let me cover up the house. She had made a postcard, and look, it's the grumpy guy. It says, be my Valentine or I'll be so mad that I'll stick my mouse on you. Now, this one she made, this is a postcard. Now, here's the card she made. I'll get to that in a second. But she says, dear Dee Dee, here are a few more birthday cards for you to use. She even put postage on each one, so that's really handy. I put postage on each one of them to help. Hope you have a great Valentine's Day. Thanks for all the coffee and art streams. P.S. Still not a card maker. These are more like mini mixed media, LOL. Well, I love them. So there's my little card from CB. And here's the card she made. All right, so here's from a non-card maker. Calling you out, CB, calling you out. All right, so here, look at these cards. Birthday, she has a little definition of the birthday. Look at all the layers, guys. And the glitter, and I'm just going to show them off. Look at the little. And again, I don't know what die cuts these are from, if they're a punch, a die cut, or what. If anybody wants to know, then ask CB where she got whatever, which ones. So there, see, look at that. The shimmer, the gold. Where's a Happy Diane? And then look, she also put card things on the inside. It says, wishing you a special birthday. So for those of y'all that don't know, we have a birthday list, which by the way, don't tell Rachel, I have to get hers in the mail. So I think I'll pick one of these and send it to Rachel. I got behind on the happy mail. I mean, on the birthday mail. So I'm going to go ahead and send out Marches as well. So I'm ahead of the game, because when it has to go across the pond, it takes longer. So I've got Rachel's going to get one of these. Sorry, Rach. And, she did sign it. Look, she did put CB. The last batch she did not sign. So, yeah. So, that's that one. I really think Dee should send them all to you to review, Eileen. Yeah, Eileen is the one that usually sends the batches. And I still have some of Eileen's left to send out as well. I try to send out everybody in the group a birthday card. Okay, so here's another one from CB. This one's on a white card, hang on, and it's got a stamp, a birthday sentiment stamped in. But look, those are each little individual layers. There's like, I don't know if y'all can see this, but look, that's three layers on each petal. So I don't know if it's a punch, a die cut, or whatever, but there's like three colors stacked up on each petal, and each petal is like, has a little die cut. I mean, I don't know if it's one thing. I guess it's one. And then she put the little jewel in the middle. And then the background is, that's a die cut or a punch there. And then the background is, I don't know, some kind of a paper. I don't know what brand or who made it, but I know. Aren't they lovely? And again, she put a stamp on each one for me, which is very helpful. Thank you, CB. This one has celebrate, and this one looks like she took a scrapbook paper and cut out all the different layers. See, she cut out like, what do you call that? When you cut out the layers and stack up the layers, there's a name for that. Somebody tell me what that's called again. Where you take the same thing and stack it. Look, see, all that's all pop dotted up. There's a name for that, though, when you cut things out and stack them on top of each other. So you can kind of see. So it's just beautiful. All right, the next one. This is so cute. Well, it's layering, but there's a name for it. Eileen, help me out there. You know where you take the same image, the same three flowers, and you pop, 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 pop them up. It's layering, but there's a name for it. I'll think of it, or one of you will. Here's a... I have no idea where she got that. look at that. Did you draw that, or is it a stamp, or what is that, CB? Well, it's not decoupage, but something like I don't know. Anyway, y'all know what I mean. I was thinking decoupage too, but decoupage isn't puffy, is it? It's layered, but it's not puffy. Dimensional layering? Okay. All right. Well, that was so cute. This is your favorite one, CB. I love that. Pop Dottie, funny sister woman. Look at that. So I don't know if she drew this, it's a stamp or look, but she's got a little string. Look, can you see that? She's holding a little string in her hand and in the happy birthday. I When's Happy Di's birthday? Look, with the glitter and stuff. I have to look it up, but look, that just says screams Happy Di with the glittery. The glitter fairy. Like the glitter fairy. I know. All right. So then the next one, she said quite a few. I don't know, but that's, let's see, that's four, five, six, seven. She sent like eight different ones. I know. And this one's hope your birthday blossoms into lots of dreams come true. And again, all those layers. Look at all those layers of little flowers and die cuts and little centers and I don't know. And then look, the tiny little, look at that little tiny bow there. I know. Now this is from CB. I'm not a card maker. And then happy birthday sentiment and another layered piece of paper in there. And yes, she did sign them. Dines in June. Okay, thanks, Linda. And then this one is, I like all of them. It says, we would never forget it's your birthday. And it's a little tag attached to the trunk of the elephant. And wishing you a special, it's got the sentiment stamped in. But look how clever that is. It's like attached to his trunk. We would never forget. Oh, maybe that's, yeah. When I forget somebody, I need to send that one. Yes, I know, right, guys? You're officially a card maker, CB. Mixed media layerer. And this one, look how cute this one is. And it's got, this is like a glossy accented type of paper, where they have the shimmer on it. And look how cute. Is this one of those gorgeous girls? Is that how you say it? Gorgeous girl stamps? So cute, CB. But look at this, guys. Look. There's a little twine there. Look at the detail, 'cause look. Look. These are individually done on a little cord. She's holding a little tiny cord there, and those are, see? Look, little tiny flowers on her shoes. Can y'all see the detail? Yeah, I guess you're right. That one needs to go to Ray. Shh, don't tell her. We're going to send that one to Rachel. Because I forgot. Oh, so yeah. Isn't that cute? Just all the layers. Amazing. Beautiful, beautiful cards. I'm making your head. Well, it should. You did a great job. Appreciate that we like your work, CB. This one's another one that's funny. It's your birthday, be a star. And look, this little cute little stamp frog. And look, each one of these guys is individual and glittered. And look, how cute is that? Look, holding up the star. They're all just adorable. Adorable, CB. And then this little. Love it. So thanks, CB, for all the extra birthday cards that will be sent out. And if you get one of these cards, acknowledge it to the girls if you are on Twitter or you see them around Facebook or at somebody else's stream. Tell them that you got their card. So, because I don't, I mean, I am here telling y'all I'm gonna send Rachel that one and probably Happy Die that one, that kind of thing. But otherwise, I don't tell you who's getting what. So when you get it, let the person know if you can, if it's, if you can, let the person know that you got their card And like I said, this one, these are CB. Here's CB, her little signature down there. Okay, so that was CB's happy mail. Let me put that with my grumpy cat. Not trying to tell me something, are you, CB? Just kidding. All right, and then the last happy mail I got was an envelope with a bag full of goodies and a nice letter from Packer Die. If y'all remember, Packer Die lost her Sophie puppy a few weeks ago, and I had sent her a drawing in memory of her. So here's the nice letter and some of the things that Packer Die sent us. Dear Dee Dee and all of my artist friends, thank you so much for all your kind words when I was dealing with the sickness and passing of my sweet doggie Sophie. It meant so much to me and I'll always remember it. Dee Dee, thank you so much for the portrait of Sophie. I can't wait to have it framed with her paw prints and a photograph. But most of all, thank you for being you. You are such a blessing to everyone. I have learned so much from you, and the gift that you give all of us is so important. Your streams have helped build a wonderful, caring, and supportive group of amazing ladies, and I'm so blessed to be a part of it. We all are. The easiest way for me to thank you all is to send you a package full of goodies to be given away during your streams. Thank you all again for all the love and support that you have given me. Love and hugs from Nebraska, Packer Die. So, and she has pretty handwriting. Look, it's all printed. Very pretty. And also, if y'all don't follow Packer Die on Facebook and Instagram and YouTube, I think she's Packer Die everywhere. Packer D-I. And so she sent, look at these, you all know we love our napkin art. Look at these beautiful, she sent a stack of them. And so they're the cutest little birds ever. Yeah, Annabelle, if anybody here in the group wants to be on the birthday list or be on my email, I do not give out your addresses to anybody. If you send me your address, if someone wants to put in my email address, send me your address and your birthday and I'll put you on the birthday list. And Eileen keeps a master copy birthday list. But I don't give out any addresses. So if you want to be on anybody else's mailing list, you'll have to email them individually because I don't give your address to anybody in the group. I just don't give out addresses. So, but I will put you on the birthday list and all that. So just email me your address and your birthday and I'll put you on the birthday list. So look at those beautiful napkins. And then I saw different, I don't know if this is the exact versions that I saw on her Facebook and Instagram and around on the net, but I saw some similar to these, and oh my gosh, they're so, so colorful. So let me show each one individually. And she does, it's from an, I guess from a different ATC swaps, but she has her information on the back. And they're all layered up. I don't know if you can see the different, it's like with dilutions and different, I don't know what that, it's not, not glossy accents, but it's some other kind of glitter something. And look at the arrows. They're all just, I love Packer Die's colors. She has the best colors. Feel the power. Hey, Marie. Okay, I missed something, Packer Die. Let me try to scroll back. She said something about, okay, I missed what Packer Die said. So if Packer Die would you or somebody cut and paste it and tell me it again. Golden Gold Mica Gel. Okay. But they're just so, I love them. I know that it's probably not capturing the, there. See, they're all very sparkly. You use Dr. Martin's liquid watercolors. Okay. Thank you, Di. So there's those. I'm going to get the bag open here. There we go. notice. Let me see about these. These are, I don't know if they're, you know, from swaps or what, but it doesn't matter. They're gorgeous. Look at that. Now, is that a glossy accent or is that the same? Is that something different? What is that one? Pack or dye? These are coated with some kind of a varnish or a gloss, some kind of a medium. So if y'all don't follow Pack or Dye on YouTube and Instagram and Facebook and everywhere, she's always posting cool things. But be prepared now. You're gonna have to buy some Girl Scout cookies. I know. I love her color. Combinations. And her collages are this way as well. She has just does great work. So y'all follow her. So there's those. Let me kind of stack that out and show you what else goodies she sent here. Different sheets of ledger paper. You know, we love these in collage. Ledger paper. Soft gloss gel. Golden soft gloss gel. Thanks, Packer Dye. Ledger papers. Some architectural, like out of an architect's blueprint type looking book. Love this stuff on collage. Y'all know we do. And then some different, like, I don't want to say that, like a scholastic, but some kind of a scholastic book where they teach, you know, about different. It's not Nat Geo, but it's because they're the kind of papers that are in like kids' books. And there's all kinds of things on Egyptian stuff. Now, you know who's going to want this. Do I even have to say who's going to want this? Do I have to say who's going to want this? There's some duplicates in there, so I don't know. Anyway, yeah, it's see educational. It says McDonald Educational. So I knew it was out of some kind of a... But anyway, where's Linda, art unit? You know, she loves the Egyptian stuff. So thanks, Packer Dye, and thank you so much for the nice letter to all of us. It's very sweet, and, you know, we are hoping that a school textbook. Okay, yeah. Thanks, Packer Dye. Yes, Eileen, Linda. I know. So the chat's like 30 seconds behind when I say it. So then I see all the wows, Linda, yeah. So, yeah, we'll probably have to get some of that to Linda. Okay, so thank you so much, Packer Dye and CB and Eileen, for all the cool stuff. So we'll be doing a couple of giveaways here after a while. And, chair is stuck on something. Hang on. Let me fix this. It's hooked up on something on the rug. All right, there we go. No, I have not got a new chair yet. I still got a Hubster squeaky one. All right, so any questions on anything so far? Thank you. Thank you guys for sending in goodies to give away. We love giving away stuff. Not yet, Lindsay. We haven't sketched any animals today. Not yet. I'm just showing happy mail and project planning and a little bit of a haul. Now, to get on to the project, I have two different things to show you. So after Sister Woman, you know, a lot of us have done the rubber band binding. Laurel even did one over the weekend. So if y'all haven't seen Laurel, but I think she said she didn't record. Anyway, sip of coffee. It's hard for me to remember who records and who doesn't and when they can't. I'm trying to get through the last hour and 15 minutes of Paula stream that I still haven't got through from Saturday night, I think it is. Oh, one other thing. If y'all are in Michael's area, there is a two-day 25% off entire purchase, including sale items for President's Day. And so, of course, I have lots of other things, half off of buy one, get 50% off yarn. And you know, and I don't work for Michael's or anything, but I get these in the mail and I get them on line, but I just want to let y'all know that there is a two-day 25% off your total purchase, which was yesterday and today. I got to get a frame and a couple other things. All right, so I've tried to pre-make some of the projects, and I'm not going to show you the final result till I get the signatures done. Great file folder pocket. file folder. Okay, Carrie, I'm not sure if you're talking about what Laurel made on Sunday, because there's a lag, you know. Yeah, links are open. Paula and anybody else want to put their links in for their channels, their YouTube, their Ustream. Feel free to, for any of the new people that want to, Laurel did. Okay, yeah. All right, so, okay, I'm getting too many things in my head. All right, so I'm going, I already folded before the show. I folded a bunch of signatures for the, so that it doesn't take forever to, I'm not going to sit here and fold seven pieces of paper and seven signatures on camera just so that you, you know, fold, fold, fold. So I went ahead and pre-folded different color signatures. I did a couple gray, a couple craft, a black, a cream, and I kept this to show you that these are Michael's brand cardstock. They're just the Recollections brand cardstock. They're 65 pound weight, which is good for sketching. And they're, you know, they're not as thick as my 110 pound white cardstock that I get from Staples for collaging on, but they're good for something like what we're doing here. So I just pulled out a few of the different color. You can get them in, let me see, I think I have the pink stack. You can get them in a stack of shades. Like here's the pink one, and they come in all the different colors. Here's the pink one. I didn't put any pink signatures in here because I didn't want to draw in pink. This was for a different project, but you can see they're different shades of pink. You can get them in all different color waves, and they usually go on sale. They're 8.5 by 11. There are 50 sheets, and you can get a stack of gray. This one had three different shades. No, this is just the solid gray. But they come in, some come in wave shades like this. Some are solid colors. You can get the black, the craft, the cream, all in one stack. And they're usually on sale all the time. Three packs for $10. So that is 150 sheets of cardstock for $10. So you can get them for a really good deal. All right, let me put that in here. So I just, these are the colors that I used today. Michael's just has a black 110 pound color, which is bad. Yeah, now this is just the 8.5 by 11. When I get the other kind of cardstock too, Jean, for like, you know, I get different ones for the cameo cutting out, and you can get them in 12 by 12 and also the 8.5 by 11, which these are perfect for like making books with. So I got craft, cream, brown, dark brown, chocolate brown, grays, different shades of gray, shades of gray. And there we go. So I pre-folded all of them, and let me kind of set this aside. And I am going to cut some covers for those seven signatures out of some more of the Tim Holtz. Now it's just, it's not, it's about the same weight as the paper here. Probably about 65 pound weight scrapbook paper. The 12 by 12, and I showed these on a stream a couple weeks ago. This was the Wallflower, I think it's called, Wallflower Collection. I think that's what it was called, Wallflower. So I'm going to, I just cut one just to show you, and then I'm going to cut six more sheets real quick, and then I'm going to put together the seven signatures with the rubber bands real quick and show you what I do with them. All right, so let me, I got my cutter here, got everything handy. If y'all have any questions, put a Q and a colon. All right, so just the 8.5 by 11 folded in half is going to be the size of the signatures. You can make these any size you want depending on what you're using for the cover. We lost focus there for a second. There we go. But what I did is I cut my cover sheets down to 11.5, what was it, by 8.5 by 11.5. So it's just a little bigger over the edge from the 8.5 by 11. You know, gives it a quarter inch on either side is what I'm saying. So this is instead of a, 8.5 by 11, it's 8.5 by 11.5. So that gives us a quarter inch on either side. Does that make sense? So I'm gonna cut six more sheets down. So like here's the sheet, so you can kind of pick the section that you want. So I'm going to first cut 8.5 here, and then I need 11.5. So I'm just gonna cut off a little bit off the edge here. And then this will be the cover for one signature. And I got seven signatures. And I really should hit it with the bone folder here so that it's crisper. Okay, so there's two. Let me put this. There's two. And I'm just randomly picking them here because I've already used, I already used seven for the other project. All right, so here we go. Let's cut this down to 8.5 by 11.5. These sheets are more are 12 by 12. So I'm cutting the 12 by 12 sheets down to 8.5 by 11.5. There's three. Four. I'm making this quick. I'm making this a quick project here. Four. Let's see what else I have here. Five, six, seven. Like I said, I've already used a lot of this up on, let's see, maybe I want this one going that away. So I think I'll cut this one this away so that I have front and back. Floral. And again, I should be using the bone folder to get it nice and crisp. All right. This is just a quick way to do some more rubber band type books. Well, I make them for, oh, let me cut off a quarter. I make them for sketchbooks. I don't do date books. I don't do planners. I showed y'all, and I'll do a quick rabbit trail on that in a minute. One, two, three, four, five, six, one more. What happens when I try to do planners? Don't email me. Nothing wrong with planners. If you're a planner person, that's fine. I love the books. I love the Midoris, the faux Midoris, the Hobonichi. I love all of them. If that blank paper inside. Or grid paper, something that's just for sketching. All right, so these are just the covers for the seven signatures. So let me just move that off the desk. Uh-oh, I need my, I do need the focus cards here. All right, so I think I'm done cutting. Let me move the cutter off of there. Yeah, are y'all asking where I got the paper? Yeah, the Tim Holtz wallflower paper. I got it on sale here a couple of weeks ago. And the destination pack as well. Both were on sale at Mike's for 50% off, I think. And then I also got the one, oh, hang on, it's in that stack. I showed it last, oh, when I got it a couple of weeks ago. The also picked up the vellums, which, you know, you can put these in there too. You can decorate these any way you want, but I showed all these too. Let me get a piece of white paper to put behind so you can see the vellums. They're gorgeous vellums. I think I got them upside, put them backwards. So you can see the vellums are just beautiful. I'll quickly show them again. There's one of each of the vellums. There's two of the other, stacks, I believe, but there's one at each of the vellums. I always get everything on sale. I don't pay full price for very much of anything because there's always coupons, there's always sales. So these were the vellum sheets. Just kind of quickly running through them there so you can kind of see them. if I'm missing any questions, guys, put them in caps, okay? Because, you know, y'all are talking so much amongst yourselves, it's hard for sometimes to know if you're talking to me, Vern. And then here's the ones that are 6x6 that are in the regular paper stack. They did some 6x6 vellums. I'm going through these really fast. The 6x6 vellum and also the 3x3s. There's three sheets of the, and then the 3x4s, and I think the 3.5, the ATC size, 2.5 by 3.5. So that was all the vellum sheets. And I think it's, they were normally like $14. I got it for like $7 or something like that. Okay, so there we go on the paper. Okay. So what we're doing with these, I have two different things that I use. What got me on this is, you know, after having done so many rubber band books, like I showed y'all earlier, if y'all weren't here, what I do with them. This one I made a few years ago out of file folders and a Scrabble board for the covers. And then they pop out like this. This was a project we did a couple of years ago, maybe three. And with different themes. And so there's 12, one for every month that we did that project. And then the one that I'm using now is my current desk journal with just 11 by 14 printer paper folded in half to make the signatures. And so it's just a chipboard book, and it's just for my, like, sitting on my desk and throwing stuff in. But what I wanted to do was think, well, what can I use that I have around here to make this, do the same type thing with the rubber bands, speaking of which, I need to get some more rubber bands, without having the rubber bands show on the spine. And the thing is, you still have to be able to have access to, you can't just glue them down. You can't just glue a cover over the rubber bands. Because if the rubber bands break, you have no way of replacing the rubber bands, and they will break after using, especially if you use the book a lot, the rubber bands will break. So you want to have a way to replace the rubber bands if it does break. So if you just do a, spine like this and cover it up so that you don't see the rubber bands, you know, glue something over it or whatever, you can't get at it, is what I'm saying. You can't get to those rubber bands to replace them if they break, if you cover all that up. So I went around the house and looked for some things that I had. So I found two things to use, and you may or may not have something like this, but they're not, they're cheap to get, or pretty inexpensive, I think, if you want to find something similar. But first, let me go ahead and quickly put these signatures together. And all I do is, I got 7 sheets of each. No particular reason. I just thought 7 was a good number without getting too bulky. But since I think I got 7 in each, maybe this one had 8. And then without them getting too bulky, because they do flare out at the ends once, you know, as you stack them. Okay. And then I'll put each one in one of these little covers with the Tim Holtz paper. And because I left an extra 1/4 inch on each side, more bigger than the 8.5 by 11 paper, it just barely covers to the end because they're flaring out a little bit. You see what I'm saying? You know what I mean, Vern? They flare out a little as you stack them. All right, so like there's one signature. Okay, and then I'm putting a rubber band on each one. Okay, so there's one. So let me just quickly put these together. I had all these folded before the stream, so you didn't have to watch me cut and fold Well, I didn't have to cut these. The other ones I did on the other, the smaller book. I didn't want you to have to sit here and watch me cut and fold, you know, however many hundred sheets this is, and then find the middle and rubber band. Okay, so there's the second signature. And basically what we're doing is just making little signatures, like you can, you know, that come in your different little, I know there's a name for them, but like the little Midori, is it Travelers, Paula? Travelers books? I don't know. There's different names, and there's even Moli has, you know, similar type little books like this. And if you can, you know, find books that are already made. What I like about doing something like this, though, is I get to pick the paper. I get to pick the paper. I can, this is some craft paper, some cream color paper, gray paper. I've got a signature here with black paper. And you can put you together a book, a sketchbook. Oh, I forgot to show you my year-o record keeping there. I'll show you that in a second. Okay, so there's black. And then again, this is just to make it like cohesive. The little Tim Holtz covers, that's just, you can use whatever kind of paper you want, or none. You don't have to even put a cover on it. It's just, for me, it just makes a little bit of a little cohesiveness with each signature. Having, you know, different papers in each signature, this, it just makes it look good. You know, little signatures out of the Tim Holtz papers. Okay, so let me do, I got another cream color one. So I'm just putting each folded sheet inside the other, seven of them each. And you can put more papers in a signature if they're just a thin printer paper. But with cardstock, you don't want it to get much more of a flare than that. Okay, so here we go, another rubber band. Two more to go. Another gray one. Just one inside the other. Real quick. Like that. Another one of the Tim Holtz papers. Another rubber band. Yeah, I'm not a bookbinder. I'm not a sewer. I don't, you know, and if you do that, you know, great. I mean, I probably would love to be able to take the time to do it, but I just haven't. So we just put all these together like that. The last one. And don't throw away your scraps here. We'll put those in a giveaway. And then the last one here, cover, rubber band. And now we have our seven signatures of all different colors of cardstock for sketching in or drawing in or whatever. All right. So there we go. Two cream, two craft, two gray, and a black. All right. And you can see how thick that makes that. So this, if you don't have any other option, make you, just like I showed you on the other two books with the rubber bands on the spine. If you don't have any other options, just make you a duct tape and chipboard covers and just put the rub, you know, put this on the spine. That's fine. But I wanted to do something different with the signatures and without buying a Midori. Not saying I never will. Paula's tempting me, I'll tell ya. Paula's tempting me with her Midori. I'm trying to behave. Oh, before I show you what we're going to do with that, let me show you what I was talking about. Here it is right here. When I try to, this book, is this it? Is this the one? I think this is it. Okay, so one year, this happened to be in 2009. Here was my version of Life book, documented life, planner, keeper, writing down everything you do. This was my version in 2000 and 2009. There's me, and look how little the kids, the grandkids were there. Okay. So, and I can't even get it all under the camera. It's 12 by 12 scrapbook paper. It's a basic gray Christmas paper that I use to do this project. And it's ring bound. Okay, it's just the loose ring bound. everyone wants your. Oh yeah, and also yeah. Let me tell y'all about Linda White Holloway. I call her Art Unit. If y'all follow her on Twitter, or if you do follow her on Twitter, go look. She made a cougar dory. So what Scrapper Sisters did over on Saturday, and go check out their blog, scrappycampersisters.blogspot.com, to get the links to their Ustream and all that to see what they made on Saturday. They made duck dories. They made these little, these kind of signature books using duct tape for covers. Well, Linda used the kind that looks like an animal print, and she's calling hers a cougar dory. So we got duck dories, cougar dories, faux dories, mud dories. So anyway, yeah, check out Linda's blog and our Twitter as well. So I made this in 2009, and what it is, I used a calendar, a regular 12 by 12 calendar, and I covered up the calendar part with pretty basic gray paper. And the idea was, I had this great idea. I was going to fill out everything I did every day in the little 1-inch squares that are on a calendar. Okay. I'll just kind of flip this open just so you can see. So in every square, I put everything I did that day. I made beautiful dividers with my own little, look, see, there's February. Does that say February? Yeah. Here's my February page. I put pretty flowers and ribbons, made my own tabs, and I used a regular, like the blank calendar sheets, and I wrote down everything I did that day. Boring or not. And then, everybody says, well, everybody has fun things that they do. And it wasn't so much whether it was boring or interesting. That wasn't the point that got me. What got me was I got so obsessed with writing everything down in 2009 that by October I could not wait for the year to end. I will not, and I even tried, I gotta say, last year on Documented Life, I went made me a notebook and was gonna do it. And I thought 3 days, and maybe it was even 2 days in. 2 days in, I thought, remember. Remember 2009. So I'm all for anybody that can document their life, keep tabs on everything they do, interesting or not. It wasn't the point of whether it was interesting or not. For me, it was the obsession of documenting everything. It was driving me crazy. Now that's just me. If you can do that and you enjoy it and it's fun and no stress, then go for it. But I'm just saying, for me, just for me, I cannot do this again. I cannot do this again. So I do not do planners. I don't do any of that stuff. I love books. I love mini books, leather books, handmade books, sketchbooks, drawing books, but they all have to be blank for me to draw in. If I want to write something down, an idea or something, I'll just jot it down on a post-it note in my composition book, and those will get transferred into my idea notebook, which is not date sensitive. And that's why I was real specific when we started doing the idea notebook, that it's not a planner. It's not a planner. It's not date sensitive. It's idea sensitive. So you can write down your ideas and what you're doing anytime, and it's not doesn't have to be filed under a date. Okay. So he does a lot of writing. I do a lot of writing and a lot of note taking. And whether it starts off on a post-it note, a composition book, a scribble in a composition book, or in something like what Eileen said, those little something like one of these. Or something like just the little tiny moly, something like that. or these little composition books, these kind of things. I'll write a lot of stuff down, but it's not dated. It's not a date. Well, I'm not saying I don't put a date down. I don't. It's not like a diary. It's not like a diary. Let's put it that way. I don't write down everything I did, ate, went, called, talked to, whatever anymore after 2009, because I could not wait. I could not wait for this year to be over. I just, because, but I wasn't, I said, I gotta finish it. Okay, so that's going back on the shelf as my reminder. No more of that for me. It's just me, guys. Don't, I'm not saying there's anything wrong with it. Just for me, I cannot do that. Okay, so back to how we're going to bind these sketchbooks. Yeah, that's a good one. Dana just said she follows Pablo Picasso's philosophy. Painting is another way of keeping a diary. And like I said, there's nothing wrong with writing down. I write down tons of ideas, and that's why we're doing the idea notebook. I'm not saying don't keep your ideas. For me, I'm just talking about the day-to-day, little things that you do every day that people like to, and that's beautiful. If you've seen the Hobonichis and the all that, where they draw their little things that they do every day. It's gorgeous. I love it, but it's just not for me, is all I'm saying. Okay, so what to use to bind these? Let me move all this stuff. So there's two versions. All right, the first one, let me show you what I used here. I made this yesterday while watching. What day was this? What was I watching? Laurel? I forget. Anyway, I was watching some and trying to catch up on Paula's videos. So what I did is I had this was a just a plain old leather wrap, and it came with a book in it. One of the little I don't even have it anymore. Just a small little cardboard book. Cheap cardboard, those little cardboard journals, sketchbook things, and this was wrapped around it. All right, this was just a leather wrap around it. Well, what I did to make this a Fibonacci, or yeah, not a Fibonacci, a Midori, faux Midori, and still using the rubber bands, and still being able to replace the rubber bands if they break. All you have to do, and I don't know why I hadn't thought of this long time ago, all you have to do is make you an insert. So all this is a cardboard basically to fit inside your little book cover, and this will work for any book cover. Okay, see how the slots there? This was just a little, had a little journal in it. You wrap this around and you tied it. That's all this was. But it had these slots in it. Okay, had these slots. So all I did was with some of this cheap cardboard corrugate that comes inside the calendars, that see how it's flexible? It's already got a bend to it. That's what I wanted to use. I wanted it to be flexible. So all I did was put my signatures around that, and then take the cardboard and tuck it into the book covers. There's the front. You just got to work it in there, and you cut it to size. You make your signatures and your cardboard to fit whatever size of cover, obviously, that you want. So you just slide the little cardboard inside of the book things there. I didn't get it quite all the way in there. Let me kind of work that in. I wanted it kind of tight so it wouldn't move around. Okay, and there we go. Well, I still didn't get it all the way back in there. Hang on, guys. Let me kind of shove that in there. I want it. There we go. You just put the cardboard into those flaps, and then you don't have the rubber bands. Okay? And then you can just tie it up, just, whatever. So anything, any kind of a book cover that you have with the slots in it will work for this. So I looked around. What else do I have? All right, and I'll show you what I used in a minute. Let me show you the. I made another one of these. I wanted it longer, And so I just take two pieces of the corrugate together. So I did this so that you wouldn't have to watch me do all this, because I figure you can see what I'm doing, right? All right. So now what I'll do is I'll take one by one. You just take your signature and you just wrap it over and put it into the middle of your book. This is just like if you were making a regular rubber band book with a with whatever, with your what do you call it? Game boards or what, however you make it. You do the same thing. You just put it on your cardboard, put it on your chipboard. You just put your signatures right on. Maybe it'd be easier if I go the other way. I don't know. Just make sure they're not upside down. However you want to get them on there. And they're a little tight, but you want them a little tight so that they're not flopping around, you know? I made mine the exact same size. Okay. So I'm just going to put all seven signatures on this piece of cardboard, like so. And then it takes a little finagling to get them neat on there. You know, just take your time. I'm kind of rushing it a little bit here. I'm getting all seven signatures on my cardboard. One more. And then let me kind of fussy with them just a minute. All right, so I got all seven inside the cardboard. Now let me just kind of fix them a little bit here. You just kind of straighten them out. Move them, you know, get them together. Get them all on the spine like that. All right, so you can fussy with them and get them, you know, neat as you can. You'll see there's a couple there that need to be a little more fussy with. So just do that like that. Okay. And you can get them a little, even a little neater. Like I said, I'm kind of hurrying here, but you get the idea. Get all your signatures on your cardboard, because this cardboard now will fit in an old Bible cover. So not only will you have a book, your own like Midori book, you just put, slide the cardboard into the covers like that. So not only do you have you a Midori, faux Midori, but you've also got pockets for your pencils, inserts, all kinds of things that you can do, and it zippers. So you have you a sketchbook faux Midori in an old Bible case with a handle. So here's your whole little studio that you can carry around. Pencils, you know, put your pencils in there. You know, you got all kinds of little slots, and depending on what kind of Bible cover you have, this one I just had laying around on my bookshelf. So I just went looking for stuff to use. So there you go. So you got your, see? Yeah. And yeah, and you can get Bible covers really cheap. You see them all the time at yard sales, on sale. And you know, there's all different sizes too. So this one, I just made it fit a standard 8.5 by 11 sheet of paper, folded in half, and just put it on your cardboard. And the cardboard just slips front and back into, and you can cover this if you want. You can cover your cardboard if it bothers you to see a little bit of it sticking in there. Okay? But the thing is now you've got a full, you know, art journal, and plus there's tons of space in these things. At least there is in this one. There's a whole nother section, two zipper pockets on this one. Where's the zipper? And so you can put in the back section here, there's a place for a notebook. There's pockets here. You can put your pens and pencils, you know, you can do, you know, whatever, you know, and whatever else. A Swiss Army knife of Bible covers. Yeah. Exactly. But what I wanted was just something where you did not see the rubber band binding on the outside. And then this one, you got the whole benefit of a little studio on the go. Yeah. So anyway, guys, so there's the little project. You do it a little bit neater. And like I said, if it bothers you to see the cardboard, just cover the cardboard with your paper before you put the rubber bands on it. And do it a little neater. I'll go in there and, fussy up my rubber bands neatly. But the thing about this is if a rubber band breaks, all you have to do is just pop out your cardboard and replace the rubber band. And then, put it back in there like that. And so you got your little sketchbook with whatever kind of papers you want. And it can be big, it can be, smaller ones, there's littler ones, there's, and then like I said, if you just happen to have some of these kind of like book covers that are like with at Barnes and Noble, around just the cheap little booklets. Well, then just make the same principle. Anything that has flaps front and back, anything that has flaps front and back, you can just put it on the cardboard and then make your little faux midori and then, just tie it up, like that. So I just made this one yesterday. This took about, because I did have to cut these papers down. These papers I just folded in half. Other than the cover I cut, but these papers are just 8.5 by 11 folded in half. These I did have to cut down. So this one took me about an hour. This one took me 20 minutes. Just folded those papers in half, cut the little covers, and put them on the thing. So there we go. So there's two little sketchbooks here with multiple papers and whatever you want to use in it. Okay. Everyone's going to head to Walmart and get some Bible covers. Well, the thing about them is, like I said, the nice thing about them is you got all kinds of little zipper things to put pencils and markers or whatever. And like I said, this one had a separate section too with two zipper areas. So you got two zipper areas, one for your book and one for your supplies. And then it's all protected too, and you got a handle. So there you go. So old Bible cover, an old piece of just a, I'm sure it's a faux, well, maybe it is real leather, I don't know, but it's a leather leatherette, book covers. So just look around your house and see if you have either these or some other idea. Yeah, that's true too, sister woman. There's a group for that. So whatever way you want to do it, it's just another little dust there. It's just another something to do for making your own Midori type things. And like I said, these are just all my own cardstock color papers because I like to draw on colored toned papers. Like here, that. These are my favorite, and I'm probably gonna, you know me, I deconstruct sketchbooks. I've got a couple of sketchies going on for the sketchy site, but these are the papers that I like. This one, and they're not a whole lot different than the papers that I just showed you, but a tone tan and tone gray by Strathmore, and they are 80 pounds. So they're a little bit heavier than paper, but I like to using these for my little faces that I do on sketchy. I know I've shown you these. Let me kind of flip through. I got some that I'm working on. I won't show you the ones that are in progress, but like these. These are if you are on. I know Dana and Linda are both on sketchy. What they do is people post photographs of themselves, and I posted a couple of myself, and then you draw them and you upload it, and everybody gets to see what you've drawn. Well, all the ones that I do for Sketchy are in these little, I won't show you every one, but all the ones I do for Sketchy are on these little toned paper books here. And here I even did, I know y'all were around when I did this one of Jay, did a Urion J. Oops, sorry, I got to hit the camera. So I'll show you a few of them here. And these are all color pencil and acrylic paint on these Strathmore paper. And then this one was a husband of a friend of mine on Facebook. And let's see, there's another sketchy. So these are the ones on gray paper. And then I have some here on, let me show you the ones I have here on, oh, that's just white paper here. Here's the tan one. Okay, so then on the tan one, I won't show you the ones that are in progress because I haven't posted them yet. I want to wait till I post. Okay, so this one is, I did someone actually posted their dog. Someone posted their dog on Sketchy. And then there is my friend on Facebook. This was a sketchy. She actually posted her pic. That was the selfie she took. So I drew her. That's how she looked. So that's how I drew her. And let's see. I really like how her eyes turned out. And then let's see, what else do I have in here? This one. And here's Dave. And by the way, I know I've talked a lot about Dave Gaskin, and y'all saw the book I bought from him of his concept art and his other art that he's done. He's in the UK. He's the one that told me about Sketchy. And by the way, he is, and he's Biker Scout on YouTube, and he just did a cool tutorial on using grids to draw. So now I don't use grids on these, but he did a tutorial showing you how to use grids, and y'all see me show, well, maybe I'll do a little quick demo on a quick way to do a grid. But he did it, he did his on, he showed how he did his on a app. I mean, on a, not an app, well, I guess it's an app, like in Photoshop. He showed it on a screen share on his YouTube. So go check out Dave Gaskin, who is Biker Scout on YouTube. Here's another one. So these are all on Sketchy that I uploaded. And then this is a friend of mine's daughter on Facebook. Not related to Sketchy. It's just that I did it small. This one's on Sketchy. Oh, hang on, guys. It's telling me to plug in my... Let me unplug the phone and plug in Lappy. Okay. So these are all, what did I say, five and a half by eight and a half is the size of this little sketchbook. There's another one. Another one. I really like the way he turned out too. And then this is one of my friends on Facebook, Marshall. And he actually made that face and posted it on Sketchy for people to draw. These are all posted by the person themselves post the photographs of themselves, and then you draw them. Same for this guy. Do I have any more in here? Let's see. I've got one I want to do of Annie and Denise that aren't done yet. Oh, here's a couple more. Oh, I forgot I even did Sister Woman and all right, well, this is another one I did on Sketchy. I really like her eyes too. She turned out, I like the way she turned out. Now the pictures that I drew of Jonna and Darcy were like real tiny pictures that I got from CHA. So I didn't get as much detail on them too, on those two, because the pictures were so small, but I did my best. So there's Sister Woman, there's Jonna, and then Darcy. And like I said, I used real tiny pictures of them, so it was a little tougher. Do I have anything else in here? Oh yeah, and also we all recognize APG, Poet Girl. I can't talk like her. You know how she does on her videos. And so there's Jamie with her purple hair. I think that's all in here. And then, so that's what I wanted to show you, though, showing that I like to do the toned paper. And so the same thing goes for, like, where I'll just show you quickly the ones that I did of Annie and Denise here. And there's Parker's dog. Well, here, I'll show you a few of these. I won't go, I think I just showed some of these last week, so I won't get into them too much. But the, some of the crew from Gold Rush, and this book is, it's the same thing. It's a Strathmore toned paper. Now this is, these are 12 by 12. I got a couple of them that are 12 by 12. But this book right here is the toned Strathmore paper. And I'm trying to look at the size here. Let's see, let me get the cover. It is 9 by 12. Now, it's the same exact paper as that small sketchbook, but it is just, so there's that one. Here's Parker's dog. And I posted these, they're on Facebook and Twitter and all around, Instagram. And then Annie and Denise, I drew them. Here's Annie. It's my daughter in LA, Annie. And then Denise, here's she. Got her here too. Here's Denise. It's flashing out a little, guys. It's a, they're a little flashed out, but I think you get the idea. And then what else? Oh, and then here, one of the Gold Rush guys asked me to draw him with Reagan. So there's that. Again, guys, it's, sorry it's kind of flashed out, but there he is. And I just put a flag kind of between them, and then, you know, their work hats, you know, his hard hat and his cowboy hat. I just kind of like the way, I don't know, I just kind of made that up. You know, just to have the flag kind of flowing between the two of them. And what else do I have in here? I mean, I got all the crew. I'm trying to go through, all, draw all the crew of Gold Rush. And so I show most of them. Some of them are just on, just the, you know, the, just an 8.5 by 11. So here's some, I'll just kind of go through them real quick again. There's Parker. So I'm working my way through the whole crew. And then here's, there's the Hoffmans. I love how his little beard turned out. And then here's Tony and Monica and Parker and his granddad. So I'm, you know, working my way through the crew. I got a few more to go, but I pretty much got the bulk of them done. I just love the show. I really, you know, I'm just a fan. This just, you know, I'm a fan of the show. All right. So there's that on tone paper. So I think I've shown you everything on sketchbook paper, tone paper, the books. Oh, okay, so then, like I was saying earlier, the big, oops, hang on, I'm tipping over. I'll pick things up before I fall. Y'all will hear me go flying. Oh, and then also, here's my most recent commission. Again, another, this was a commission. That's Teddy. It's all in black and white and gray. It's hard to see. It's 12 by 12, so I can't get it up under the camera very well. All right, so I think that's all I got to show as far as anything current, except for my animal book. Put this paper away before I trip over that. All right, so in my big Mama Jamba, this book, my very big sketchbook, and I've had a couple people ask about it, and it is 600 sheets, 75 pound weight, and I think it doesn't have the, where's my little ruler here? It doesn't have the size on here, but it is 11 by 13, I think. Yeah, so it's about 11 by 13, and it's the very big sketchbook. Amazon, get it on Amazon, and depending on, you know, if you got Prime or free shipping, it runs about, it's about, I think around $25. Okay, I froze for a second, guys, while I was getting mail. Thanks, Lindsay. Thanks, guys. All right, so out of breath. So this is the very big sketchbook. I did have a couple of faces in it, and I thought about doing port, you know, but I got so many other things. I do portraits in like the tan and the gray and the toned papers. I said, I think this one I'll just use to sketch animals. And before I hit record, I was explaining that when I'm normally sketching for myself, where I'm gonna, especially if I'm gonna add color to it, I just, you know, like washes, like with the Neo colors, you know, like if I'm gonna use Neo color 2, and I say 2 specifically because if you get Neo color 1s, they're not water soluble. Only Neo color 2s are water soluble. So I always make sure and try to say Neo color 2 because those are the water soluble ones. But if I was going to add any kind of washes, whether it be this, watered down acrylics, watercolor washes, whatever, just to give some color to the drawings, then I draw with a light touch. I draw with just these technical Papermate number 2 pencils, disposable. You can draw with whatever, but my point is it's a light touch. I barely see it when I sketch it because knowing I'm going to add, you know, other pen and ink or pencil or watercolor washes on. But for the camera, I need to use something like this. These are my favorite going out and sketching pencils. If I'm out like life's draw, you know, sketching out in public or the museum or the aquarium or the botanical garden or anything like that, these are what I like to use because I can get so many shades and tones with them quickly. Not even really caring if I'm going to put water, you know, color on it or not. So anyway, that being said, I'm using these pencils, these woodless graphites in this book so that they show up on camera. So like I did last, whatever day it was, I streamed last week where I worked in this book drawing those animals. I had to spray them with a fixative before I could add any color to them. So you've seen a couple of them where I've added some watercolor washes to them. They were sprayed first. They were sprayed with a fixative, you know, like just a workable for pastel charcoal pencil fixative. You gotta take it outside. You spray outside, shake it up well. And a tip on using this, which I don't spray a lot of my stuff because I have to for the camera. If I'm gonna use thick pencil, I'm gonna have to spray it if you wanna see me do any color on it, because it'll smear. But I hadn't used it in so long because I don't spray fixative. I don't do pastels very rarely. And I just don't spray things. But so a couple of tips when I was out spraying them that I remembered. One, you always want to make sure it shook, you know, shake it up really well. And the other thing is spray it upright. Don't like lay your book down like I had done that with this one. I laid the book down and I started spraying like this and it started dripping. I went, oh yeah, I forgot. You have to hold your book up and spray straight on. You want to hold your can up to spray. Don't try to do it like that because you'll just get drips, which most of the time they'll dry clear. But if you've got a pastel, which that doesn't apply here, but if you've got a pastel drawing or something that's you really want to fix and not mess, you know, nothing happened to it, you don't want a big drip on it. So make sure that you spray straight up. Okay, does that make sense? Know what I mean, Vern? and lightly mist it. You don't need a whole lot, just like that, a couple of whooshes over it, but don't do it down like that. Stand your book up, or your sketchbook, or your piece, whatever, stand it up and spray it. Okay. All right, so I've done is pretty much sprayed these. I sprayed them, except for a couple that you saw me post. I haven't worked anymore in this since last week. I did those other two commissions over the weekend, and so I really, you know, haven't had time to play in my sketchbook, which that's what these are. They're quick animal sketches, just picking some animals off of, you know, zoo pictures, Google zoo images and stuff like that. So you can see that, well, let me see if I can move my camera setting up just a little. There we go. And so they're ready to color. And, the, you know, put their eyes in. So I did do these two, a white cat and a black cat, both with the same color green eyes. And so I'll try to, I can't really, let me not zoom, I'll just hold it up. So here's the black cat. I'm trying to get you so you can see the eyes. There's the black cat. And then here's the, this book weighs a ton too. I mean, like how many pounds is it? Does it even say? It's heavy. 600 sheets of paper in here. And then there's the green eyes on the white cat. So there's just something that I've colored in. And here's some, and this one got a little smear even before I sprayed it, because I did have a lot of, there's even some leftover pencil shavings that I sprayed over. My lemurs, and again, I love my lemurs. Let me show you the, this is the one that I use on my Facebook and on my YouTube channel. So this is the lemur that I did here, and that's what these lemurs will look like. So you can see they're rough sketches, but if I want to add, you know, paint and other things to it, I had to spray them first because they're so thick. When I just draw them out for myself, like I said, I use a thin pencil that won't show up on camera. So they're just rough sketches. We did this one where we added a little lipstick, eyeshadow and fingernail polish to a little hamster. and the other eyes aren't done in or anything yet. You know, they're just quick sketches. And then I'm working on this frog. This is as far as I've got on him so far. Really not even, I'm not even done with the eyes yet. I still have all the shading to do in the eyes. But I just kind of blocked him out. I'm going to have him on a green leaf and, you know, some kind of a jungle something there. And this is just started out like this, and there it is with some color on it, just so you can kind of see. I probably will color most of these just because. We started with a little bit of a green leaf because I'm going to do leaf ears on him. Same thing, we did a little pink on this little possum, fierce possum. And then there's our little groundhog, not groundhogs. Were they groundhogs? No. What were they? You know, those ones that stand up. Are they groundhogs? Anyway, not meerkats, not groundhogs. Prairie dogs, prairie dogs. Some prairie dogs, a black crow, and our penguins, our steampunk, started steampunk looking seahorse. And then these are the two fish that you saw me post. The lionfish, you saw me draw them last week. And so there's that one with color and there's that one with color. It's flashing out, guys, but I think you can still kind of see it. I think you can kind of see it, even though it's a little flashed out. I'm trying to capture the real color, but it's there, kind of there. So you can, I'm trying to get it so you can see the real colors. But it's hard because of the lighting and the camera flashing. And that's all. That's all I got in here. So that's it right now, guys, that I have done to show you. And the main thing I wanted to show you was doing those books and how to use, you know, some leftover covers that you might have to do them. Thanks, Eileen. So yeah, so it's fun that, you know, I still have my list here that y'all gave me for all the animals that we want to draw. I added another raccoon and a sloth because y'all know I did those raccoon and sloth sketches on other paper and I really liked them. I wanted to put them in this book because I'm going to try to have this whole book be just animals. So here's another ringtail lemur. This one's just, you know, lightly, it's a little bit lighter than how I'm trying to do the darkness so it shows up on camera here. But you can just see, these are just pencil sketches with just the eyes done. Okay, What color did I use for the water? I used some, one of these two colors of Neo colors. I don't remember which one. One of these two dark turquoise. And then I also used a combination of, I mixed my own blue with these three colors. Well, you can't really see, but I used these three colors in kind of a marbleized look. I mixed my own blue with those. And very dry. Let me go back over there. It's very dry, guys. You can't go crazy. This paper is not watercolor quality. It's not made for, let me move my wax paper. It's not made for, and it even, it's still wrinkled a little, but I kept it as dry as I could. Okay, I kept it pretty dry. Even when I'm doing washes, like the little, with the watercolor, Neo colors and watercolor brush, I still don't oversaturate it. This paint's very dry. It's almost dry brush. So that it doesn't, you know, and it still warps the page a little, which I don't care about that. But you don't want to get it so saturated that you're going to poke through to the back side. Because this is only, what did I say it was? But wait. 75 weight paper. So, you know, it's not even cardstock weight. So you got to kind of be careful on the wetness of it. And then, so anyway, I want to add, oh, there's Grumpy Cat. I want to add some of these others, like here's my emu, and here's a sloth. These kind of, I want to add these particular animals into my animal book. A raccoon, I want to put another raccoon in there. So I'll redraw these, but if you notice, look how light the pencil is on that. So you don't really see a lot of pencil, but I have to do it a little darker so you can see it on camera. There's a dachshund. So I'll probably read, just like I'm doing the lemurs. I love my lemurs. I could draw lemurs over and over. I'm re-adding lemurs in here. I want to re-add a sloth, a raccoon, that kind of thing. Okay. So anyway, you like the fish ones? Yeah, JJ liked the fish ones too. I might need to add some more JJ fish, the Nemo fish, the clown fish. Couldn't think of what kind they were. So, yeah, and so, yeah, any, you know, if y'all have an animal to add to my book, I'm trying to, I'll probably rewrite this list. I just did it during the stream where we could, I could just write them down quick as y'all were saying them, but I'm going to add a camel, a chipmunk, a horse, a pig, a lizard, an aardvark, a squirrel, a cow, a Maltese, a raccoon, a sloth, a bear, armadillo, some more fish, an eye for Eileen, which I don't even know what that is. I don't know if it's a bird or some kind of, I don't know. I'm sure it's something native to Florida. Octopus, fox, grasshopper, ladybug, a seal, a crab, a lobster, a buffalo, hedgehog, a platypus, a warthog, a butterfly, a monkey, a mouse, and a wolf. And I mean, there's thousands of animals. We won't have any problem filling this book up as time goes on. And that's what I want to do. I just want it to be all animals. So I'll sketch them. I'll sketch them on the show, and then I'll have to spray them. These are all been sprayed. I have to spray them before I can go in with any kind of paint or watercolor or washes or whatever. Peacock. I think we have a peacock on the list. No, I have one. I have a peacock saved picture, but I didn't write it on the list. All right, where's my Sharpie? Write that down. So, yeah. Tasmanian devil. Margo, where are you? Are you in isn't that a native of Aussie? A Taz devil. A rat scary. It looks like a scary rat is what an eye looks like. Go figure. Eileen will not let me put a flamingo in here, but she wants a rat-looking, scary-looking thing. Okay, I haven't even looked it up. Anyway, guys, so yeah, so that's the one I was kind of working on here. And I just do, I'll do washes, and then I go back in with color pencil and shade, just like I would a portrait. You know, and depending on how much time I have, how much detail I want to add, you know, I could just stop with this and be happy. Or I could go back in there and work on his little toes and some more shading. Or, you know, it just depends. Just depends on how much I want to add. But I want to at least have the sketches. I want to have the sketches in the book, whether or not I add a bunch of color to them or not. Now, the ones that have just plain white eyes like this, obviously I'm going to put eyes in them. You know, I love doing my eyes. And where's the cats? So, I'll at least do the eyes. If I don't do a lot of what else in there. But, you know, so anyway, they'll just be fun to color and play with. Like I said, we already put eyeshadow and lipstick and a little beauty mark on her. But, like, you know, there's no eyes in there. Oh, and the other thing I did do as well before I hit it with the spray, when I was like just shaping the eyes real quick in the sketch, before I sprayed it with the fixative, I did go in there and like get out any excess pencil, thick pencil out of the middle of the eyes, unless they're going to be, you know, like where they're just solid black right now, where I'll either paint them out or whatever. Where's the ones with the like here, like the giraffe. There, it's more solid black in there, but that's where it's probably going to be pretty much black anyway, with a wash of color to make them look wet over them. But otherwise, I will kind of like get some of the excess graphite out of the eyes before I fix it. Once they're fixative, you can't really, it's not going to erase. Okay. An alligator. Okay. Alligator. So that's what, you know, when we don't have anything to do, don't know what to do on the show, want to just fill some time, then that's what we'll do is draw more sketchy animals. Because they're real quick. I want y'all to see. Oh, and that's the other thing I wanted to show y'all, the grid thing on the faces. I mentioned Dave Gaskin, Biker Scout, on YouTube, and he's the one. Let me find my book. He's the one I bought this book from. It's from the UK. I keep it in the plastic. Anyway, so he is an amazing artist and digi artist. And so I bought his book from him, but he's got a YouTube channel, and he was showing how to do grids. And he showed how to do, he used a screen share to show how he did it, to compare it. So check that out. But I wanted to show you a quick, now let me see, I'm not prepared for this, so let me find something to use as an example. Two different things I need. Because I don't remember where I kept the grid where we my sample from before. If I can just I did find it. Okay, good. I don't have to redo this. All right. So I don't have the picture for this one though. Me get out some of because I was talking about, oh, and there's that. I was looking for that. Some of my. For those that we talked about drawing faces and different techniques and things, and we've done this before. So most of y'all have probably already heard all this and seen me do all this over the years, but we'll go ahead and do it quickly. Also to recommend this book. And the only time I really ever use grids anymore, and I don't even do it in my own murals, is if I'm doing a mural commission and I need something pretty exact on somebody's wall. And even then, it's only with certain things that really have to be laid out, like let's say a city or some kind of something that's very exact. Technically, it has to be exact. Then I'll use something with a I'll use a grid for a mural. But other than that, I really don't use grids anymore. But it's a good tool if you're not if you don't draw a lot and you want to get in the, a more proportioned face. I'm not necessarily even saying realistic. Let me get a magazine here. I'm not even saying necessarily realistic, but if you just want something correctly in proportion and you're not practiced at it, a grid is great. All right, and I want to also readdress this book again in a minute. All right, so I need a piece of paper. So I need to, let me just get some printer paper here. So I'm just going to do a quick little demo and show some of the things that we've talked about before. All right, the easiest way for you to make you a grid is just with a page protector. All right, let me get a piece of paper behind me so you can see it. Just take a page protector and a Sharpie, and you can make your grids in whatever size you want. Mine are in like 3/4, about another these this one's an inch one. These are inches, but you can make them smaller if you're afraid that you won't get de enough detail with an inch. You can make these as small as you want, but I would recommend trying to do something like this with at least an inch. You get too small, you're gonna just try it with an inch first. And all you do is take a page protector, and you can make, and you don't even have to have it in a this is just a like a cardstock little frame. You don't even have to do that. It just makes it easier to kind of keep it flat. All right. Is if you have it in a little frame like this, and then a Sharpie. You want to do it in a Sharpie so that it's permanent. And even a Sharpie will smear while it's wet if you get in there and scrub it on there. Okay. Y'all with me? Following me so far? Let me take a sip of coffee here. So there's two ways that you can use, well, there's multiple ways, but I'm going to show you two ways you can use the grid. One is if you just want the exact same size. If you just want to, let me get a magazine here and let me find a close-up of a face. This was just a magazine the Hub's gotten. Oh, here we go. This is a good one because it's big. All right, let me just tear her out. Good example. All right, one way to use the grid is if you just want this exact size on a paper. Okay, you want to just draw her the same size. Then you use the same size grid. You use the same size grid on the paper that you're using. In other words, and I'm going to do it kind of dark so you can see it on camera, but you would want to do this really lightly, like with a thin. A light touch. All right, but I'm going to do it dark, so not that dark, so that it shows up on camera. But you would make this grid very light, and I'm making it 1 inch, just like this is. Well, actually, is that 1 inch? Okay, no, I'm making it too big. Hang on, let me hang on. I'm making it too big. It needs to be an inch. I was making it bigger. So you want to make your grid. Let me just mark up the inches here. And I'll start with the first one, just making it. I'm not really planning. I didn't plan this out, but I want you to. You would take your time and make sure these were straight. I'm just going to use the edge of the ruler here to make sure I'm straight. But you would really want to take your time and get this, get your grid. And again, not this dark. You would want to take your pencil and just make the grid. Just light enough for you to see. It's not even, this is an old one. You would want to just make your grid just light enough for you to see. See, you can barely see that on camera. Because otherwise, you're gonna, because you remember, you have to erase that grid. If you go like I'm showing you here, this heavy, you're never going to get it erased. All right. But I'm just doing a quick demo so that you can see how it works. All right, so Is there any questions? Are we good so far? Yeah, I would recommend drawing it on the paper. You could do it if your paper is really thin, but most of the time, if you're going to do something, a drawing, you're not going to do it on transparent paper. So it doesn't really do good to have it that dark if your paper's not, if you're not going to see through it, you know. You just want to do it lightly. You just want to do a light grid. Let me just get a start here. And again, I need to measure. Just do it lightly so you can erase. If you're trying to see through the paper, you probably won't. Let me turn it so I can get them sort of straight. And I mean, you're not going to probably take time to do, well, you might to practice, you know, draw something real detailed on scratch paper. You know, that's a lot of work for a piece of scratch paper. Bye, Xander, and anybody else coming and going. All right, and like I said, go check out Dave Gaskin, Biker Scout, and he'll show you. This is just, you know, this is just a tool. And like I said, I don't do this with my drawings, but if you're not used to drawing, getting proportions right, this is a good tool. All right, so I'm just going to take this magazine image, and you want to tape. You want to make sure this is not going to move. Now, I'm not going to take the time to do it right now, but you need to make sure this grid does not move. If your grid moves, you know, it's going to be hard to get it back exactly. You want to tape this down exactly where you want her. All right. Also, you might want to number, if it's hard for you to kind of just count in your head, one, two, three, it's you know, where you are on the grid, you can always number this. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine. You can number them so that you can find your place. And if you want to start, let's say, like Dave likes to start on the nose, right in the middle, or find a middle spot. If you've already gridded this out, it's not so, it's either way is fine because you're going to count out your squares. But let's just say you want, just for the sake of showing you what how to follow this. Where's my pencil? So her nose is at, let me kind of get it, I don't want to move the paper, at 5 and 5. All right. Do you see that? It's at 5 and 5 is where her nose is in that square. All right. So you could also, if you wanted to, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay. Now remember, this is going to be very, very light. So I'm going to go down here to 5 and 5. 1, 2. Oh, let me make sure here. 5. Is that what I said? 5 and 1. And it's on the 5 line. So right in here and right here. So this is where her nose is going to be. Now I'm just showing you this for so you can see it on camera. But in here, let me try to hold this up. I need a better piece of paper behind this. It's too flexible. So here we go. Her nose is in down line 5 in that square. Here's line 5 and it's in that square. And this is just, you know, for you to it helps to have a starting point. If you start up here on the hair, you could do that too, but you might lose. It's just better to do it this way. All right, so in here, you look at just that square. You look at just that square and you draw what's in that square. Okay, or you don't even have to necessarily draw every shading. You can just get the proportion of where her nostrils are. Her tip of her nose comes around this way. I shouldn't have put that big circle there. Let me erase that big circle. That was just to show you where the square was. Just so you can find it. And then you can see the tip of her nose comes around this way, right on that line, which I've moved, right on that line and comes around and stops there. So there is like where her nostrils are. All right. So, and you wouldn't think that maybe her nostrils are that big, but they are because you're drawing a pretty big face. All right, so now what you do is you can just follow along the grid and find. I don't know if y'all ever saw these in your newspaper. They had those little puzzles where they'd have grids and you had to just color in whatever The squares is kind of like that, but this is not jumbled. You know, those were kind of like jumbled. And so what you do is you just look at the picture here. Like for instance, her eyeball, her pupil is right like that. So you can get the proportions. All right. Let me see if y'all are following me or anybody paying attention. You remember those puzzles, Margo? So this is what you do if you want the exact same size. You look at this grid and your grid are the same size, 1 inch to 1 inch. If you want this picture to be big, now here's where let me get another big sheet of paper. Here's the back of something. Then what you'll do, and depending on how big you want it, let's just say you want her this big. This is just the back of a sheet of paper. It wouldn't be folded and it would be probably like that, all right? Then let's just say you want to double this. Or maybe not double, maybe well, let's just say that. Okay? Then what you're going to do is then you'll do this is going to be way bigger than it's going to fit on this paper, but I want to show you how it works. I'm going to do 2 inch grids. Okay, so this is 1 inch, and I'm going to double the size up to 2 inches. Then you're going to make double the size. It's going to double the inches here. So this is 2 inch grid. All right, and I'm just going to do a bit here. Let me grid this out. And again, you'd want to do these grids very lightly. And I'm not being real careful here, guys. You'd want to make sure your grids are really neat because your drawing is only going to be proportionate to how well you drew the grids. Okay, thanks, Sister Woman. All right, so again, let's just say you're going to do just her face and not her hair. Okay, so let's just kind of line up what you want to draw. Let's get her eye. Let's get her eye right there. All right. So her eye, if you can see, fills up that grid and goes over a little bit. You see? Now I'm going to try not to move it. You really need to tape this down, but I'm not doing it for the demo purposes. All right, so here we go. We're two over and one and one, two, two or three and a half down. One, two, well, let's just go three. Let's just go there so you can keep it in. All right, because you can number these one, two, three, four, just like you did the other one. So right above the four line, right in here, you would draw that eye, but bigger. You're going to draw it, you're not drawing it the exact same size. You're drawing it to fill the square. Look how far up and down from the square her eye is. You see? You just look at it and you know you can it takes a little practice, any kind of drawing does. But this is just a way for you to get your proportions right if you're not real good at doing that by sight. All right. Her eyebrow's way up here, but the curve of her eye comes down that way. So there's her eyebrow, is way up there. All right, her pupil. So you just continue to draw what you see here and draw it down here. But do you see how much bigger it is? That's what I was trying to get at. It's double the size. Okay. See? It's twice the size because you made this grid bigger. All right. So if you want it the same size, you keep your grid the same size. If you want it bigger, you make the place you're drawing bigger, but make sure you have room. Now I want to show you something. Her face is not going to fit on this paper because we made the grid so big. But if you wanted to make a big, like a poster size, if you wanted to make her a poster size face, then you would do this grid this big. Always makes me feel like I can. You can do this, Sister Woman, but here's the thing. Most of y'all don't try. You know, you don't get out the paper and do it. It's not going to do it itself. You're not going to get it like, you know, you can get the technique, by me showing you, but you're not going to get the results of learning how to draw quickly and without a grid unless you do a lot. But I want to show you, if you do want to do an accurate, and again, you're probably not going to sit here and shade every exact thing. You may for practice, but you're probably not going to do that. This is just to help you get the proportions right. And like I said, if you just want the exact same size, then you go grid for grid, inch for inch, you know, for the same size. If you want it just a little larger, then maybe make your grid an inch and a quarter or something like that. Just, and you'll have to play with it to know how big it's going to get when you do that. I'm not, you know me, I don't love math. Where's Sherry? But this is how you can get the proportions right. Because a lot of people, they look at this and they think, oh, you know, here's an eye and here's another eye. Well, those eyes don't look like that. This eye may kind of be shaped like that, but this eye over here is that. And then there's her forehead. But because you're just used to thinking an eye looks like this, you're going to draw the other eye like that too. When that eye is cut off by the side of her face and her cheekbone, you see? So this method will help you see. Now I'm going to go over, because this other stuff happened to be in with this, I'm going to, and I'll keep all this because I know it's going to come up again and I want to have all this handy. Some light went out. Oh my, okay, there it goes. My bulb just got dark. Okay, so here's some of the other things that we've done. Showing practice, how to practice your some different pencil things here. I don't even know what all is in here. Pencil, water, washes. I just picked up this whole stack. Okay, where's that? Let me get that magazine again. Okay. Another way to practice your proportion. All right, let me see if I can find some tracing paper here. Hang on. All kinds of little graphs and things here that I forgot about. Oh, that's a palette. I don't need a palette. Let's see if I got some tracing paper. That's a palette. That's a canvas pad. Hang on, guys. I'm trying to find a piece of tracing paper. I don't want to just reuse these. Well, I might have. Oh, here we go. Okay, I got some. All right. I didn't want to grab out a... Let's see. Let me grab a piece of tracing paper. I didn't want to have to reuse these, but I want to show y'all again some ways to practice your proportions if you're like, just another way to practice. Okay, so get a magazine and practice full bodies if you can. And not just necessarily, here's a good one. Well, that just, her feet are covered up. Let's see. I don't have a lot of fashion magazines. I have a couple. Oh, wait, here's a good one. This might be a good one for an example, face-wise. If you take some tracing paper and practice shapes two different ways. I don't know. Did I lose you guys? All right, two different ways to practice your shapes and see to see things. And then I also want to go back over this book. Then we'll go. And then we'll do a giveaway. All right, two things. I'm going to draw with a Sharpie just so it shows up on camera. Take a tracing paper and go over, look for shapes. Let's start with his neck. Look for the shadows and the shapes and just draw the shapes. And you can get as detailed of the shapes as you want. But what you're trying to do is train your eye to see the shapes that you probably may not realize how foreshortened his nose is, for example, or how his eyes are looking up a certain way. And I'm even having a hard time seeing. This is in the dark there. I picked a too dark picture that I'm not being able to see through. But you may not realize that when you're drawing, look how his head is. You see, your eye doesn't want to tell you that's what that face looks like. You like this tip? Yeah. So this helps train you to see shapes. And I'll do a body here in a minute. But the other thing is just take a Sharpie and a fashion magazine. Get a big, giant 600-page Vogue, or however many pages those are, and a Sharpie marker, and go through every single person in there and find all the shapes with your Sharpie marker. This is just practice. You're not trying to draw this person. You are practicing shapes. You're looking at how the eye is looking up, how his nose is tilted up. There's a circle there. His chin is there. His lip comes up, like kind of curls up. It just gets you practicing shapes. You see? And the same thing if you do full bodies. Here's one that we did before, where you'll just get the shapes. Practice seeing the shapes. Let me see if I can find a full body here. Because here's the thing, when you take away your paper, you will be amazed at how small or big something might be. All right, so for instance, here's her face, and she's got her hair, but look where her eyes are, look where her nose is, look where her mouth is. So right there, look how far down her eyes are on her head. So many people want to draw. Hang on, I gotta get another piece of paper. So many people have a tendency to draw a face and the eyes way up here, and the nose and the mouth or whatever, but there's no head. And look, that's really not how it is. This is where her eyes are, down there. So when you do this, try to keep the shapes like elbows, knees, okay? And just try to keep the shapes. Shoulders are right there. There's her neck. What this does is just helps you. There's her hand foreshortened. This hand is kind of like that. What this does, and the less clothes they have on, the better. Like, I'm going to ignore that bag and just make her body there. There's her hip there. There's her knee way down here. Her foot's foreshortened now. Her foot's bent back. So it looks like she's got a little stub there, but she doesn't. There's her heel, and her foot goes off the page. But this helps you to see shapes rather than just thinking what you see. Now take that away, and then that's what she, well, other than right there, that's what she really looks like. Look how small her head is. Her head is the same size as her hip. See that? You did a whole magazine. It was fun. I know it is. And it just helps you to, just what it trains your eye. It trains your eye to, but nothing is better than just drawing from life. I mean, you're not going to get anything better than that, but this is a good way to practice, Okay. And then if you do some tracing paper ones, then you can look at it and study it. But this stuff takes time. It takes time. It takes practice. You don't just, wake up one morning and just draw a photorealistic thing. It's not going to happen. No, just telling you. So there's a couple things for getting your proportions using a grid, practicing with some tracing paper, going over, shapes just to compare. There's the shape of her, how big her. Let me do it on the tracing paper. Here's her face, and look how big her hand is. Her hand is quite large. Her face is quite small. But when you do a lot of that, and the more, of course, just the more you draw, it will just help you to. Let me get another face. Here was that girl that I just saw. Let's do that tilted head girl. We'll do her with a pencil. It will help you with your proportions. Let me just get a. Do I have space there? Let's see if I got space on one of these other pieces. Okay, so her face is She's tilted her face up, but if you look at where her head is beyond the hair, see, then she's got the hair is off of that. Okay, just so you can see how big her face is. Now she's looking up. So you just want to kind of get the, there's her nostrils, just so you can see how small things are on the face. There's her eyebrows. Things are smaller on the face than you think, even with big full lips and all. All right, look how small everything is. Okay. Let me put her pupils in more clear. That's how big her pupils are. That's the real proportion. Now, there's nothing wrong with drawing the, funky, the fantasy faces. And I'm just here, I'm just talking about getting realistic proportions, not just doing our, what do you call them? What does Jay call them? Whimsy. Because we do, we have these, do the big old whimsy eyes and the big eyebrows and the little tiny nose and maybe a little, there's nothing wrong with doing those fun things like that and playing with them. But if you want true proportions, even if you don't draw a photorealistic picture, I'm not even talking about drawing photorealistic here. I'm just talking about getting your proportions right. This one I think is Hobby Lobby brand, sister. You can get it anywhere. This is a little thicker. You can get it anywhere. Just go look in the painting section, I guess the painting section. Okay, so look how small her eyes are. And her no nostrils look big because she's looking up. So you're seeing up in her nostrils. Okay, this was when I showed the demo of negative space drawing chairs. So here's just some different ones that we've done. Here's a piece of plastic to make a grid, just so you can see proportions. Another demo for negative space. I don't even know what we were doing with all these. But I like to try to keep them because then I don't have to redo these, readdress this the next time someone asks, which I don't mind really, guys. I don't mind. I'm just, I just hope that some of y'all use this stuff. Thanks, Eileen. So practice with some magazines, either tracing things out for proportion or just taking a Sharpie marker and, drawing the shapes. Okay, there's our ears, things like that. Hand, just all, your shoulders, where your shoulders are. There's her chin. It'll just help you when you go to draw something. You already that if you do enough of these, it'll be stuck in your head. It'll be stuck in your head. You gotta do a lot of them though. All right, so there's that. Now back to this quick book, then we'll do a giveaway. Thanks everybody. Got a full house today. Thanks everybody for being here. I hope some of this is helpful, useful information, and y'all get some inspiration. That's my thing, is inspiring y'all to try and to promote other artists and what they're doing. I'm real big on that. So links, as long as y'all aren't spamming here, you're allowed to post your links, promote your website, your blogs, your Ustream, your YouTube, your Pinterest, whatever you want, your classes. If you're teaching a class, even if it's a paid class, you're more than welcome to post here and talk about it. All right. So we've talked about this book. Mine's Falling Apart. Oh, here we showed another viewfinder. So if you're out and you want to focus in on something, you can use your own little viewfinder just to show you there. Look. If you want to focus, let's say you want to draw, let me get a face. Let me do a face. Let's say you want to draw. Well, it's better to use that magazine because you'll be able to see it. This works for especially if you're out, wanting to get the proportion or a perspective on a certain thing, like a building or a tree far off. We're going to just use a person because that's what's in this magazine. I don't see any trees or anything. Okay, well, this is a nice big face there. All right, so let's say you want to draw a tree. If you're going to draw a tree far away and you want to see how that tree, oh, it's got a blue background, it's probably not going to show up. Look, so there you go. You could draw the tree like this. You could draw the tree like that. Now, and think about it when you have a piece of paper or a sketchbook next to you. Some paper here. All right, so you got your paper here. This is your drawing space. Let me do it this way so we can do a couple different things. Okay, so here's your drawing space. Okay, that's your little sketchbook or whatever. And you have one of these, and you can get professional ones of these that are connected and slide and all this. I just made one out of cardboard just to show y'all. All right, so here we got, and I don't know why the light went funky again. All right, so there we go. So you see her whole body there? So you could draw it like this. There's her hair. You could draw it like this. Or you could draw it like close up, like that, just focusing on that one section. Her whole face would fill that. You see? There's her whole face would fill it. Or you could go like this and even get down to, I'm sorry guys, the lighting just went wild for whatever reason. I don't know if it was the white paper. Or you could even just do this. You could get down to the eyeball or a leaf or a branch. Do you see here what I'm talking about? So a viewfinder like this helps you focus in on different closenesses of it. Because what you're doing is you're drawing just what's in there. You could draw all that, you could just draw that, or you could just draw that. But your paper's the same, so you're drawing what you see in there. Okay, there's another little tip. All right, then the book real quick. You should see my room behind me. There's like no place to walk. All right. Y'all with me? Still with me, Vern? Take a sip of coffee. That's true, Lindsay. And hi, by the way. All right. So this book, I've had this book forever. My copy's falling apart. It's from 1979. There are new versions of it out where she sells them with sketchbooks. They're wrapped up with the book, which is a newer edition with sketchbooks in them and stuff like that. So this is just my old copy, and like I said, it's falling apart. But this is a great, it's called A Course in Enhancing Creativity and Artistic Confidence. And it's basically, for me, the easiest way to say this is her book teaches you to draw what is there, what is actually there, not what you think you see, but what is really there. Because we all, and I know I've shown her examples here. All right. So for instance, this person, and now remember, these are back in the 70s. This book is an old book, but I don't know how much it's changed. Maybe she's got updated things. I don't know. But this person in September, that's what they thought this person looked like. You see these same shape eyes? I'm gonna do a drawing here in a minute, Stonetta. And speaking of Stonetta, I followed you on Twitter, but you have to accept me. You have to accept me before I can tweet you. I mean, give you links and stuff. So you have to go on Twitter and follow me or accept my follow, Stonetta. All right, so this was, I just saw you there. I didn't even see you in here, so thanks for being here. So this person started drawing a face, just looking at a life face, and this is what, I'll go back and look, because it said pending. When I followed you, Stonetta, it said pending. I'll go back and check again. Thank you. Because I wanted to give you links. For those of y'all that are here, Stonetta is Anna, and she is trying to get some of us to, you know, new on Twitter. So if y'all want to tell her your Twitter names, maybe you could get a couple of them now, and I'll give you some more on Twitter when it's been accepted or whatever on Twitter. All right, so here's what this person saw when they started. They looked at the eyes, they saw two eyes exactly the same. Okay. But after September, 2 months, September, yeah, 2 months, that's how well they drew. Okay, from that to that, in 2 months. Now, mind you, there's practice involved. But what her book does is it trains you and gives you exercises and different kind of things to train you to draw what you see, not what you think you see. And the quickest, one of the quickest tips that I can tell you to do is to try to draw something upside down. Just pick a picture out of a magazine, turn it, don't stare at it, don't overthink it, just turn it upside down and draw it upside down. In other words, don't try to draw it right side up, turn it over and actually draw it upside down. Draw it upside down, okay? And so then when you turn it over, you can see how close you got. But that's one of her techniques as well. So the whole book to me, it's really worth, I don't even know how much it costs now. I don't even want to give you, this was $10 back in 70, whatever, 8 or 9, what I say. And so, but it's still out. It's in new editions and they come with sketchbooks and I don't know what. I should just buy the new edition. There's a difference from drawing things from memory and having someone something. Well, yeah. And I rarely draw things from my head. I'll do things like, for instance, when I drew that seahorse, looking at seahorse, I can draw like maybe metal, like I wanted him to have metal armor coming down. I could imagine where the little screws would be and stuff like that, details like that. Most people are even concept artists who invent things. Let's say they're doing a dragon. They may have reference of pterodactyls or chicken feet or whatever else a dinosaur, a pterodactyl might look like or a dragon. So what I'm saying is, most artists, if they're drawing any kind of realistic, they're using some kind of reference. I mean, you can do funny faces. I'm not saying that you can't practice. We've done a lot of just little practice faces, here, where you would just draw little cute little faces and, stuff like that. But if you want to draw, most people use references. That's all I'm saying. Yeah. You don't need to draw just everything out of your head because probably what's in your head is this. That's in your head. That's what it really looks like. Do you see what I'm saying? Well, there's nothing, I don't know where anybody got the idea that it's wrong to look at a reference. Or to look at real life, or to look at a photograph of something to practice your drawing. Now, of course, obviously, the best is drawing from life. I mean, because that's your best practice. But most of us don't have aardvarks, in our backyard to draw from. You know what I mean, Vern? So you're going to have photographs. I'm not talking about inventing this out of your head. This is what will come out if you just draw. Okay, so I don't know where anybody got the idea you can't or shouldn't use reference. Burn. Okay, so let me read a little bit of chat. Well, and like I said a minute ago, Stonetta, that's what we were comparing doing whimsical, funny, fun, just fun faces. As what I'm talking about here is trying to do actual proportioned faces. And I'm not even talking about necessarily shading it to a photorealistic drawing. I'm not even talking about that. I'm just talking about getting proportions accurate. You could trap an armadillo. So yeah, I'm not even talking about drawing what's in your head here. We're talking about drawing what you see. I don't know, I've never known any artist that thinks drawing from life or drawing from a photograph, drawing from an actual thing is cheating. I don't know where that came from. I've never known any artist, not one, that thinks that looking at a person and drawing it is cheating. What, you have to just have it in your imagination? I don't get that. Okay, so this is drawing on the right side of the brain. Betty Edwards. Someone asked for the author. Sorry, I thought I'd said it. Yeah, exactly, Carol. No one thing. You look at a landscape, you draw it. You look at a person, you draw it. You look at an animal, you draw it. You look at an apple, you draw it. You don't have to have it in your head what an apple looks like. I don't. I must have. Maybe I missed part of the conversation. If I did, sorry, guys. Sorry. But yeah, you don't have to draw an apple out of your head. Now, if you've drawn 1,000 apples, you might know what one looks like, you know. You might know what one looks like a little better, you know. But that doesn't mean that you have to do that. You want to draw what you see. And that's what her whole book here is about. Drawing what you see. And we talked about the negative space and the chairs and, different. I mean, this book's been around since, I took art courses, in the early 80s. I don't know. This book's from 78, 9. I read more books before I took any classes other than like high school, you know. Okay, so I don't know, Julie. I don't know. So I don't know where I got someone said that. I don't think. Had to mean. I don't know, Mumi. I don't know. Well, anyway, guys, that aside, you want to, it's much better to take something in real life and sit it down and look at it. And draw it. Than it is to, you want to just keep looking at it and drawing it. And that's my perspective, by the way, not yours. Anyway, guys, so I hope that any of that was helpful to you. I know we've done this same show over and over many times, but I know that there's new people that come in that we haven't talked about the book or different things. All right, so let's do a giveaway. Oh, got some. I must have missed something. Packer Die says I missed our Happy Die. I must have missed it. It scrolled off. Okay. Well, if you consider a life drawing and you're in a class and there's a person there and you're drawing it, that's a reference. I'm not getting the whole reference thing. If there's my reference right there. That's a reference. I'm not drawing that out of my head. There's my reference. Okay. I don't know. All right, so let's do a giveaway. We're going to give away some of Eileen's little thing here. I'm going to give away a pack of her. I'm going to give away one of these. And I'm going to add one of Packer Died. So Eileen sent this. And I'm going to say the other book, the other little pack of books that Eileen sent will go to someone that is doing the project. Someone that's doing the idea notebook. I'm going to give this one away just to whoever's here, but the other notebooks are going to go to people that are actually doing the project. But I'm going to stick one of Packer Die's little ATCs in there. Her information's on the back, so you'll know who that's from. And the little book is from Eileen, ETEE Eileen. All right. All righty. So let's do, where's my post-it notes? Here we go. I'm confused and trying to say trauma. I don't know, Carrie. Gene didn't, if we are, can use a reference to draw. Well, yeah, he had Mona Lisa right there. I think I missed part of the conversation, guys, is all. I think I just missed part of the conversation. All right, so we are going to do, we have a lot of people. We have over 50 people here today, guys. Thanks, everybody, for being here. I'm going to write down a number between, and I know there's a lag. I try to take my time and do it slow. I'm going to write down a number between 1 and 50 off camera. And when I type in the word go, when you see me type in the word go, put in a number between 1 and 50, the person closest, without going over, one number only. I'm going to send a little Eileen little, and remember, they don't make these anymore. These are Seven Gypsies little booklets. And Seven Gypsies is no longer. And a Pack or Die ATC, a double goodie. And I'm going to try to get all my happy mail to go out tomorrow. I wanted it to go out today, but there's no mail today. So, thanks. All right. Thanks, Dana. Thanks for being here. All right. So, anybody that wants to participate, I'm going to write a number between 1 and 50. Write it off camera there. Okay. So, look for where I type in. When I type in, go. And then I'll give you all a couple of minutes. And then I'll type in, stop. Okay. All righty. So type in a number between 1 and 50. Did my chat freeze? Oh, there it goes. It just froze. Ooh, I'm going to have to scroll back. I'll have to get some help looking for it. What number did I write down? Okay. I got to scroll back. It went fast. It went flying. Okay. Give everybody a couple of minutes. And yeah, keep putting your numbers in. I still have time. Yeah, one number only, please. One number. Everybody just put in one number. You're on the Price is Right, Paul. yeah, I'm gonna run, try to get up, run over to Michael's and pick up that frame I need to get, and then come back and watch the rest of your show, Paula, before Gene comes on. You still coming on at 4, Gene? Yeah, Survivor starts next Wednesday, doesn't it, Anita? Next Wednesday? Oh, I'm Annette, I'm sorry. Okay, I'm going to put in stop. I don't see any more numbers. Let me type in stop. Okay. All right, so the number is 37, and I'm going to have to scroll back to see who got, I didn't see a 37, but I saw, y'all can help me. Anybody wants to help me see who's closest without going over? Scrolling, scrolling, scrolling. I see a 29, a 31, Margo at 31. Lindsay at 35. All right, did anybody have a 36 or 37? I didn't, can someone double check for me? I saw 35. Did anybody have 36 or 37? Gee, well, who had it first? Who had it first? Oh, gee. Who had it first, guys? Who had 36 first? Gene did? All right, let me try to see if I can look it again. It scrolled so fast. 36. Yeah, okay, I see Gene did have 36 first. Okay, so Gene had 36. Okay, thanks guys for the confirmation. So Jean, you're gonna get the little mini books. You can use them at school or whatever. And Packer Dye, a Packer Dye ATC. All right. All right, thanks guys. Yeah, I scrolled all the way back and saw it, Eileen. Thank you. All right, guys. Well, I hope y'all enjoyed. I hope y'all got some tips, some tricks, some whatever, some inspiration. Okay? Yeah, we got Jean. Yeah, Jean got it. And I know there's a lag, guys, so y'all are probably not even seeing that I know it's Jean. yeah. All right. So, any questions or anything else before I go pick up this room? Thanks, guys. And if y'all want to be on the birthday list, just email me. Let me put in my email here. Have to type it out because it won't let me put in the. You're welcome, guys. Hey, Tam, by the way, and anybody else I might have missed. Pam and who else? Hey, Barb snuck in the back door. Harriet, who else? Jess? Jess, we need to do another show for you soon. Wee Hootie, KP, Teresa, Moomy. I said hi to Moomy and Packer Die. Rooster Girl, Skip Dumaloo. I love that. Skip and Carol, Sunset Carol. Who else did I miss? Lisa. Hi, Lisa. Love my Lisa pin, Lisa. And there's Vaughn. Hi, Vaughn. Thanks, guys. All right. Bye.